Welcome back, friends. Welcome to another video tutorial from Shomu's Biology. And in this video lecture, I'm going to talk about how to solve genetics problems with probability. And I've got this request so many times, and this time I'm going to make this video about. Because you know, there are many problems in genetics that they generally ask regarding the different crosses, dihybrid cross, monohybrid cross. It's really easy, even you can solve it with your without calculating anything in the paper. But generally, when they ask questions from like tetrahybrid cross and as well as like 5, 6, 7 different characters and cross between that, it's kind of impossible to make a checkerboard and solve the whole problem with that. In that case, you only need to use the probability rule and how to use two separate probability rules to solve genetics problems. That's what we are going to see today. Now, the idea about genetics problem and the two separate rules that we use are known as multiplication rule and addition rule. Okay, is that two separate rules, multiplication and addition. And those two rules are quite easy. All of us know how to multiply and add, but that's not the difficulty. The difficulty is whenever the question is asked, by looking at a question, you need to depict whether you have to apply multiplication rule or you have to apply the addition rule. So when, which rule you need to apply, it is the trickiest part. So let me tell you about these two rules a little bit first, then I'll be showing some problems and how to answer them. So first of all, there are, in probability, what we deal with is different events. Now the events can be multiple events or even the same events, but those are independent events. That means the event can start from part, and also there is an outcome of every single event. For example, you can take a coin toss. That's an independent event. So for a coin toss, which is an independent event, what is the probability to get a head or a tail? So when you say that, what is the probability to get a head or a tail, we know that the chance is half, because there are only two sides, the possibility is two, and either one of that we are going to get, but we are not going to get both at the same time. So 1/2 is the probability for a coin flip to get a head or tail. Similarly, if I now tell you that we have two separate coins flipped together at the same time, and what is the probability of getting head in both the coins, then the problem becomes a little difficult and complicated, because here two events are working together. Remember the situation: two independent events are working together, but the outcome depends on both the results. So we are talking about these two, multiplication and addition rule, and which one to use where. And there are only two things that I can tell you is, for the addition rule, there is only one event that can occur more than two times, or two different ways actually, two different ways. The possibility that that same independent event can occur more than two different ways, or at least two different ways. While multiplication rule suggests that two events are occurring, at the same time to give one particular result. That's the idea. I hope you're not able to understand it quite clearly. That's why I'll give you one example. If a couple have three children, what is the probability of getting two daughters and one son? That is the question. Now with this only one example problem, you will be able to understand how to apply multiplication rule or addition rule in one go. That's why I'm giving you this example. So couple, three children, what is the probability of two daughters and one son among those three children? Think about the idea. Normally what we know, what is the probability of any couple to have a daughter or a son is always half, because the chance is half to be a son, half to be a daughter. So to become a son, the probability is half, to become a daughter is also half. But the question is, among these three children, two will be daughter, one will be son, right? So what we can see here two daughter and one son. What are the different ways that we have two daughter and one son? So let's think of it. Three individuals means three separate positions are there. And in those three separate positions, we have either two daughter and only one son. So what are the three ways that we can arrange two daughters and one son? It can be daughter, daughter, son. It can be daughter, son, daughter. Or it can be son, daughter, daughter. So what we have here is three separate ways there can be two daughters and one son. Daughter, daughter, son, daughter, son, daughter, and son, daughter, daughter. Now what we can look is this cumulative probabilities. Now if you begin here at the first place, that in every single spot, the chances of getting a daughter or a son is half, that we know. That is the idea. So in the first place, to be a daughter is half. In the second place, to be another daughter is also half. And in the third place, to be a son is also half. Now the question is, what we do, multiply or add? Now think about this idea. The whole thing depends on only one outcome. Daughter, daughter, son. Only one result. Daughter, daughter, son. But there are three separate events. Three separate events, but they have the same outcome. I told you, whenever there will be events, two events that are going towards, two or more events going towards the same outcome, we should use multiplication rule. So here also we have three separate events, but ultimately the result will be cumulative, daughter, daughter, son. So we should multiply them. So what we will get here? 1/8. This will be the probability of getting a DDS. Same thing, the second possibility, daughter, son, daughter. Again, to be a daughter, probability half. To be a son, probability half. To be another daughter, probability half. So we have DSD. So that is again the probability, cumulative probability 1/8. And the third thing now is DD. Son, daughter, daughter. So again, half to be a son, half to be a daughter, another half to be a daughter. And again, as we are looking at cumulative, so we should multiply them together. So get answer 1/8. Now the question is, in overall, that what is the probability for the three children, two of them to become daughter and one of them to become son? We know individually the events, if they said that first two will be daughter, last one will be son, the probability 1/8. First daughter, then son, then daughter, probability 1/8. First son, then daughter, probability 1/8. But now we know all these events together, and they are asking us that what will be the probability that two of them will be daughter, one of them will be son. So what we're looking here, we're looking one event, that event is two daughter, one son, that can occur more than two different ways. Here we can see the same event, two daughter, one son, can occur more than two different ways. Here it's occurring three different ways. So what we should do, we should add those probabilities together. So ultimately, what value will get? 1/8 plus 1/8 plus 1/8 equals to 3/8. That will be the total probability of getting two daughters and one son if a couple have three children. So see, in this one example, we see where to apply multiplication rule, where to apply addition rule. That's what I am talking about. Whenever you are reading a question, try to understand two things. One, what the question is asking. What is the total outcome of that event? And then look at individual probabilities. Then you apply the rule of multiplication or addition. If it's two separate events or more than two events have a similar outcome, same outcome, it should be multiplication. And if it's one event occurring more than two different ways, then it is addition rule. Hope you understand this part of the video. Now let's solve another type of probability problems, which you can also get generally. Like, let's say trihybrid cross with three separate genes out there, A, B, C. It can be 4, 5, 6, 7 different types of genotype can be given. And the question is, it's between two plants, and the traits are given here for both the type of parents, okay? And this is the genotype of the offspring. So the question is, what is the probability of getting this genotype if these two parents are mated together? That's the question. So how to answer this one? This one will be a lot easier to answer compared to the first one, because if you look at here, in this case you'll also see there are three separate genes. Those three separate regions are there, and for each and every one there is a specific probability that you can calculate, because ultimately you want to find a cumulative probability at the end, right? Because the outcome is one, but the events are three separate. So what we're talking about here is, one event can occur more than two different ways? No. Two or more than two events, they have same outcome? Yes. So this particular math depends on this idea. Two or more than two events are working for a same result. So in this case, we should use rule of multiplication. But how? Let's solve for it. So the first place, if you look at here, we have capital A, capital A, and capital A, small a. So between capital A, capital A, and capital A, small a, what should be present here, and how we form capital A, small a? So what is the probability of getting capital A, small a between a cross of capital A, capital A with capital A, small a? Simply, you can do a Punnett square of it, right? You can do it for like this, capital A, capital A, and capital A, small a. So capital A, capital A, capital A, capital A, capital A, small a, and capital A, small a. So between this cross, we know the probability of getting capital A, small a is 2 out of 4 or 1 out of 2. So let's write it. Now look at the second place. Between capital B, small b, and capital B, small b, what is the probability of getting capital B, capital B? Again, think about it as in a Punnett square. So let's put capital B, small b, and capital B, small b. So the chances are here is simply capital B, capital B, capital B, small b, capital B, small b, small b, small b. So what is the probability of getting a capital B, capital B? 1 out of 4. So let me write it here. And the third event, between small c and capital C, small c, what is the probability of getting capital C, small c? So again, you can do the same, capital C, small c. Let's write it like this. And here we have small c, small c. So capital C, small c, small c, small c. Again, capital C, small c, small c, small c. So again, between this Punnett square, what is the probability of getting capital C, small c? 2 out of 4 or 1 out of 2. So what we know here, you can easily do Punnett square of monohybrid crosses with one gene at least. And even you don't need to do that. I'm going to tell you one idea, one formula that is also going to give you an answer directly, not even calculating with Punnett square. But now let's look at here that we have the probability of each and every different event for the gene A, B, and C. In three separate events, we have half chance of getting capital A, small a, 1/4 chance of getting capital B, capital B, and 1/2 chance of getting capital C, small c. Now the question is, which formula should we use? Because here more than two events are working to have a same outcome, so we'll use multiplication rule. So let's multiply them. So we'll get an answer of 1 out of 16 is the probability of getting capital A, small a, capital B, capital B, capital C, small c when two parents have this genotype. Got the answer. Now the shortcut route that I am going to tell you is about this monohybrid crosses. Think about this idea. If the cross is between a homozygous dominant and a homozygous recessive, then all will be heterozygous. Then if the cross is between both heterozygous, in that case the probability of getting capital A, capital A, or small a will be 1 out of 4, while the probability of getting capital A, small a, which is a heterozygous, will be half. Got the idea? That is the beauty. And the third thing, between a homozygous dominant or homozygous recessive crossed with a heterozygous, what will be the probability? In this case, to get capital A, capital A, or capital A, small a. The probability of capital A would be half. Capital A small a will also be half. Similarly, with small a, the probability of this or this again half and half respectively. So think about this idea. Whenever there is heterozygous, both of them heterozygous crossed, probability of hetero half, dominant or recessive 1 by 4. If both are homozygous, one is dominant, another one is recessive, then the chances all will be heterozygous. And one dominant for homozygous or homozygous dominant, homozygous recessive, but another one hetero, the chance is always half for hetero, half for dominant or recessive. If you remember this, you don't need to do any Punnett square even. You just look at here, because here in this case, capital A with capital A small a, homozygous dominant and hetero. So between homo and hetero, we know the percentage of hetero will be half directly. So it's simply put half. Between hetero and hetero, we know the chance of getting a homozygous dominant. Between hetero and hetero, to get a dominant, 1 by 4, that's 1 by 4. And between, again, hetero and a homozygous recessive, the chance of getting a hetero is also half. So half. That's how you'll get an answer within seconds. You don't need to even invest a minute to answer this question. So the best thing is you try to solve few of this similar type of problems. I hope you'll come up with some better way of practicing it. And once you practice it several times, this becomes really, really crystal clear in your mind. I hope this whole video helped you out regarding how to apply the rule of multiplication and the rule of addition, which are the laws of probability, to solve genetics problems. So if you like this video, please hit the like button, subscribe to my channel to get more videos like that, and share this video with your friends. Thank you.